So primary ciliary dyskinesia is complex. So in contrast to cystic fibrosis, where you're talking about 2,000 different variants that can cause, in a single gene, that can cause disease, in primary ciliary dyskinesia, as you would imagine, there are any number of genes that, if defective, could cause primary ciliary dyskinesia. The estimates have varied, but it takes roughly in the ballpark of 600 to 1,000 different genes to encode proteins to assemble a human cilium and to allow it to function normally. To date, we have identified now over 50 genes that, when defective, can cause primary ciliary dyskinesia. So it's a little bit more complex in that it's not just one gene and a handful of mutations, it's multiple genes and multiple mutations that can lead to disease. In terms of genetics and genetic testing for primary ciliary dyskinesia, that is one way that the consortium has really changed our understanding and our diagnostics of this disease. That because we've identified more and more genes that are associated with primary ciliary dyskinesia, there are now commercially available genetic panels that you can use to look for defects in these particular genes. Now, the caveat to that is that we don't know every gene when mutated that leads to primary ciliary dyskinesia. And based on our numbers, and Stephanie, I'll give you 5 minutes for rebuttal, it's roughly in the ballpark of about 70 to 75% of the mutant alleles in primary ciliary dyskinesia you can pick up on genetic testing. But that means you're still talking about 25% that you can't. There are other tests. Historically, people have looked at ciliary ultrastructure using electron microscopy. So they want to look at the fine details of a cilium. And that has historically been used as the diagnostic test, but again, it also has limitations. It only picks up roughly 70% of people with primary ciliary dyskinesia. We have other tools that have been developed and refined through the consortium, like nasal nitric oxide measurements, where we measure nitric oxide that's produced in the nose and the sinuses. And that has turned out to be a useful screen for the disease, but it's not perfect. And there are any number of other diagnostic tools that are being developed. I think the bottom line to your question, though, is there is not one single test that will diagnose every patient with primary ciliary dyskinesia. And so they almost have to be used as a battery.
I mean, the one thing about the 70 to 75% in regard to genetics, I don't know. We don't know that exactly. I would say that's probably the right. That's probably right. I also think we are underestimating the number of patients that are impacted by or have primary ciliary dyskinesia. There's a recent paper that came out, a first author, Will Hanna, last author, Ben Gaston. It's worth looking at because the prevalence of PCD was much higher in that paper than what we typically thought as part of our consortium work. And that's not uncommon because I think we're at the tip of the iceberg of really understanding the disease itself, because there's heterogeneity in regard to clinical manifestations. I mean, the classic presentations for these patients are a chronic cough that really occurs on a daily basis. It's not seasonal, it's not based on season. It improves with antibiotics, doesn't resolve with antibiotics. Runny nose, clear rhino all the time. And sinus disease. And they can have recurrent pneumonias or bronchitis. Can be hospitalized. It's not as common as what we used to see in cystic fibrosis, though now we see it very rarely in children with cystic fibrosis. That patients can certainly be hospitalized. Infertility in men, and it is harder fertility issues in women. And situs inversus, which occurs in 50% of patients, but is based a bit on your genetic defect. If you have a radial spoke defect, for example, you don't see it. it just depends, but you do see situs inversus. So if you have a patient with situs inversus, you want to think about PCD. They can also have heterotaxy, congenital heart issues. There's a lot of overlap with different kinds of organ manifestations. The other thing is, and it's a little different depending on what paper you read, but it's around 80 to 85% of patients will have neonatal respiratory distress despite being born term. So in other words, if you're preterm, you're going to have neonatal respiratory distress likely anyway. So that's the other thing that we see. So you can actually pick it up early. So if you have a child in the NICU who has situs inversus neonatal respiratory distress and is a 40-weeker, then that is you probably want to be thinking about PCD. If you have a child with heterotaxy, who is also, I actually think we don't look at it enough in our congenital heart population. And so a lot of this has been education, but those are the symptoms that you would think about. Now, who thinks about it? I do think pediatric pulmonologists do now. I actually would have not said that 15 years ago. Adult pulmonologists might think about it. Bronchiectasis occurs in all patients eventually. And adult patient pulmonologists often have these idiopathic bronchiectasis clinics. And they don't always test for PCD, partly because they're like, what does it matter? Am I going to treat them any different? I've heard that before from some of the adult pulmonary crew. Otolaryngologists is hit or miss on whether they think about it. If maybe you're married to your wife who does PCD, you might think about it. That's my husband. Or if you're involved in research, you might think about it. But I suspect a majority of ENT docs don't necessarily think about it. And then we're trying to get out to our neonatologist. So I'll give you an example. I walk through our NICU. I'm the chair here at UNC. So I walk around different places, see how things are going. I run into a neonatologist 2 years ago who says, oh, we have this patient with heterotaxy who's been having some difficulties breathing, but Wayne tells me they don't present this early with PCD. And I said, I bet you that patient's got PCD. And sure enough, that kid had PCD. Yeah. And so this is in our own institution. We're like the center of PCD in the United States. And our own neonatologists aren't even necessarily thinking about it. So I think we need to work in that crew as well. I mean, Tom and I could go on and on and talk about this.
As Stephanie was saying, a lot of these children will present in the newborn period. They will be a term child who needs supplemental oxygen or even mechanical ventilator support for some unclear reason. But eventually it gets better and the symptoms go away. And so then the next features you get is this persistent runny nose and early infancy and this cough. But also these children often have a lot of problems with their ears. They have fluid behind their eardrums. And so then they're seen by otolaryngologists and oftentimes will have multiple sets of tympanostomy tubes placed before someone thinks, well, wait a second, this is the third set in the child's, 30 months of age. Maybe we should be thinking there's something else going on.
We looked at otitis as a differentiator. It wasn't great because so many young children get otitis media.
Yeah. But I think it's because there are features of ear infections with patients with primary ciliary dyskinesia that I think are distinctive from your run-of-the-mill child who's getting recurrent episodes of ear infections because they're in daycare.
Right.
So, but you're right. I think pediatricians in the community or family practitioners in the community, they may have heard of primary ciliary dyskinesia just simply because of the unusual presentation with persons' internal organs on the opposite side. And they may remember very little else about it.